I'm going to show you how to make these Edward Imhof-inspired terrain maps in ArcGIS Online. Imhof was a renowned cartographer in the middle part of the last century. He was renowned for his skill in creating impressionistic landscape cartography. He used hues and tones to create not just a literal interpretation of a place, but the feel of it. If you're not familiar with his work, hit pause and look him up, and go ahead and carve out the rest of your day. And yes, this is all done in the ArcGIS Online Map Viewer using data from Living Atlas. I have two main goals for this tutorial. The first one is to give you a terrain map that you can use for static screenshot applications. I don't recommend this technique for interactive maps that you might be using in an app or a story map. Beautiful static screenshots. Two, I want to show you some of the things that the Map Viewer is capable of with a combination of amazing layers, layer effects, blend modes, and styling, and imagination. Okay, let's build up some terrain. Here I am in ArcGIS Online. I'm going to change this base map to imagery. And right off the bat, I'm going to tweak how this imagery looks. I'll dig into the base map, choose the world imagery layer, and go into the effects. I'll set the brightness and contrast to 80% each. And then I'll crank the saturation all the way up. And then I'll find a topographically ideal place to use as my sandbox. In this case, I'll use Kalispell, Montana. It's got mountains, plains, water features, everything we need to kick around some of these styles in style. Next, I'll go to my Layers tab and add a Terrain Elevation image service from Living Atlas. Add Living Atlas, and I'll search for Terrain Elevation. It's an astounding aggregation of many elevation sources. It's global and covers all scales, lovingly tended to by my friend and colleague Rajinder Nagi. This is an image service. It's not tiled, which means it fetches the full screen every time you pan or zoom. But that means we have more flexibility over how it's styled, and in this case, that's what we want. Also, this is premium content, which means it's not available unless you have an ArcGIS Online subscription. So don't use it for public-facing maps because it won't load for them. So I'll add this, and it's a digital elevation model. Black areas are low elevation, white areas are high elevation, but we can change how this appears. I'm going to give this a dynamic range adjustment. That means it's not going to care about all of the elevation in the whole world, just the elevation within my view. This is perfect because it means as we pan and zoom, the color gradient will re-stretch to the new high and low within my view, so it'll always look good. Speaking of looking good, let's give this a different gradient. I'll choose this blue to brown diverging color scheme, and I'll reverse the gradient so that low areas are blue and high areas are brown. Next, I'll take a look at how these colors are stretched over the terrain. Instead of a linear application of color to elevation, I'll choose standard deviation. This ensures I have rich colors even in wildly varying topographies. The higher the standard deviation number, the smoother the color transition. I'll choose 3. I could optionally use the gamma function to skew this color gradient toward lower elevation areas or higher elevation areas. But I like it as is. Next, I'm going to blend these elevation colors into the underlying imagery. And the blend mode I'll use is soft light. This elevation tinted imagery doesn't look so hot, but that's because we aren't done yet. We haven't added hillshade. I'll add from Living Atlas the World Hillshade tiled layer. I want to burn the shade of this hillshade layer into the underlying terrain tinted imagery, and I'll do that using the color burn blend mode. And now I have an ugly map with shadows. Next, I'd like to lighten this up. So ironically, I'm gonna add hillshade dark. I want to emphasize the sunlit side of the mountains. So I'll give this a blend mode from the lightning group of plus. And that makes a gigantic difference. The world hillshade layer does a beautiful job of painting in detailed nooks and crannies of the terrain. So I'm gonna add in a generalized hillshade layer. Think less peaks and valleys and more mountain ranges. It shows the wrinkles of Earth at a more global scale. I'll merge these shadows into the map using the color burn blend mode. If I switch it on and off a couple times, you can get a sense for the shade side of these mountains, get a general shadow. And to recap, the world hillshade dark gave me brightened, sunlit slopes. The regular world hillshade gave me detailed shadows. And the terrain image service lets me tint the underlying imagery by elevation. That's called hypsometric tinting, by the way, in case you want to look that up. Hypso is Greek for height. We now have a sun-drenched terrain surface, but we don't have any atmospheric perspective. Renaissance painters would be ashamed of us. Let's cloak our world in a little bit of mist, breathe some life into these valleys. I'll add that same image image service, once again, our old friend Terrain Elevation, and I'll open up its style options and once again activate dynamic range adjustment. That's huge. Just like before, I'll set its color stretch to 3 standard deviations, and I'll leave it with this grayscale color gradient, except I'm going to reverse the gradient so that low-lying areas are white, high elevation areas are black, and it looks like it's cloaked in mist. Then I'll give it a blend mode that treats darkness as transparency, so I effectively have a layer of mist. And that blend mode is screen. I will never tire of cloaking the world in mist. It's just magic. It's the closest thing to cartographic magic that I've ever seen. Boom, instant atmospheric perspective in reality. It's just bonkers. But I mean, of course, there's too much of a good thing, so I'm gonna tone this down to be 25% transparent so I can still see through in the deepest valleys. And to do some housekeeping on this growing list of layers, I'll rename this second terrain layer to mist. Now we're on to part 2, water, where I stack up like 4 versions of the same layer. And that layer is bathymetry light. It's a vector tile layer of oceans, lakes, and rivers, just water polygons, globally at all scales. I'd like to give these water areas a seemingly impossible sunlit radial reflection. So it's light in the middle and kind of gets dark near the edges of the water. I'm gonna hack this using the bloom effect. And if I play with these 3 sliders, I can show you it's kind of a wild effect, and it's like really big difference if you move these just a little bit. And I found through some experimentation that if I give a strength of 0.6 and a radius of 2, a threshold of 0, and I uncheck that automatically adjust option, it ends up looking pretty good, like a nice little radial fill. The only problem is that it glows and the effect spills outside of the extents of the water. I want it to be constrained just to within the water. How do I get rid of that glow? So I'll add a second copy of bathymetry light, the exact same layer, and I'm going to use it cookie cutter style as a mask. So with this new non-bloom effect version of the bathymetry light layer, I'll go into the blend modes, and there's a group of blend modes called compositing. That's clipping, masking, cookie cutting, same kind of thing. I'll choose destination in. Boom. Now I can still see that cool radial sun glint effect, but I don't have any glow escaping the extents of the water. The only problem, and it's a big one, is that I've applied a mask to everything else too, not just my bathymetry light layer. So I'll create a group for these 2 layers to isolate that masking effect. What happens in a group stays in a group. Now I can benefit from that cool radial fill without any of the unwanted glow. Next, I would like to hack in a nice little sandy beach effect on the bottom right part of these water polygons, and a little dark blue shade effect on the top left part of these polygons. How do I do stuff like that? Well, I'm gonna add that bathymetry light layer yet again, a third time. I told you, this is not efficient, not for interactive apps. I'll drag this new bathymetry light layer underneath my group, but not in the group. And I'll give it a drop shadow effect. Maybe you can see where I'm going with this. I'll give it an offset of 1 pixel to the right and 1 pixel down, and then give it a nice little sandy color. And then I'll repeat that a second time, adding bathymetry light, dragging it underneath the group, giving it a drop shadow effect, but this time it'll be offset so that it appears in the top left, and I'll give it a color of dark blue. And now we have this adorable little chiseled embossed effect with dark blue shade and sandy beach. And we can check how this looks at other scales, and that water just sings. And now for our third and final unit, which is reference layers and labeling. And you may have been able to guess that I'm going to add human geography detail, no water. This is a vector tile reference layer that has streets and borders, but it doesn't have any water polygons because that would cover up all the work we've just done. It's a derivative of human geography detail. I just switched off all the water in the vector tile style editor. Both versions, with and without water, are available in Living Atlas. Edward Imhof had a way of making his reference layers sort of float off the map as a distinct item. I'm gonna use a drop shadow to achieve something, you know, similar. I'll make the shadow darkish blue in color to kind of give it an atmospheric effect, and then I'll blend it into the underlying map using the soft light blend mode. This makes it a very subtle reference, which I like. Next, I'll add a labels layer, and I'm gonna add human geography labels. It's got a great balance of feature type and feature density, what's being labeled and how much. I'll tone it down a little bit by giving it 25% transparency, and to make its white halos more harmonious with the colors of the existing map, I'm gonna give it a sepia effect. And because all of the layers I've used for this are global in extent and universal in scale, and especially because the elevation layer has a dynamic range, it'll always look pretty good no matter where you go. But because I am using an image service and not a fully tiled service for the elevation layer, this is best for capturing static screenshot exports, not for interactive stuff. If you're interested in learning more about Imhof's techniques, I've got a longer form video that dives into his methods, his way of treating light, and atmospheric perspective and using color. And there are also resources for doing this sort of cartography in ArcGIS Pro if that's what you prefer. I'll provide links to all that. My big hope is that you get encouraged at the styling capabilities in ArcGIS Online and try things out. Make your own style. Dig in. Have fun.